Vesiculobullous diseases, or blistering skin diseases, are mucocutaneous illnesses characterized by the formation of blisters and bullae, and there are so numerous a full textbook would be written on them. Most of them are acute, due to infection, hypersensitivity, or inflammatory disorders. Some, though, are chronic, and amongst these we count A. those of autoimmune etiology acquired the immunobullous, such as Pemphigus vulgaris and Bullous pemphigoid, and B. those of genetic etiology, Genodermatoses, such as Epidermolysis bullosa. Now, to say this won't be a comprehensive discussion would be a colossal understatement. There are literally hundreds of variations of immunobullous diseases and genodermatoses, and we'll be talking just about a few of the very best known. The traditional contrast between two acquired chronic blistering skin diseases, Pemphigus vulgaris and Bullous pemphigoid, for example, features often in tests. So, we've already established the major difference between Epidermolysis bullosa versus Pemphigus vulgaris and Bullous pemphigoid is that it is genetic, inherited, whereas the two others are acquired. If a child comes to you with multiple recurring vesicles and erosions, you're going to suspect a genetic cause with onset at birth or childhood, such as Epidermolysis bullosa or endemic Pemphigus foliaceus. You wouldn't consider Pemphigus vulgaris for a child, because it's a disease of older adults. In the same way, you'll never suspect an elderly patient presenting blistering skin disease for the first time to have Epidermolysis bullosa. It's more than likely his condition is acquired and autoimmune, if not infectious. Pemphigus vulgaris is found most often in patients between 30 and 6 years old. Bullous pemphigoid usually presents in people over 50 years of age and typically over 80. Therefore, in practical terms, children, Epidermolysis bullosa, elderly, Pemphigus vulgaris and Bullous pemphigoid. That said, among immunobullous diseases, the acquired ones, the great difference between Pemphigus vulgaris and Bullous pemphigoid is the location of the blisters. In Pemphigus vulgaris, they are intra-epidermal, whereas in Bullous pemphigoid, they are sub-epidermal. In very simple terms, Pemphigus vulgaris is typically more severe because its bullae are closer to the skin surface, and therefore rupture more easily. The more superficial the bullae, the easier it is to rupture it, the more delicate it is. That's why the sub-epidermal bullae from Bullous pemphigoid are tense and resistant, while the intra-epidermal bullae from Pemphigus vulgaris are friable. Additionally, the more severe disease, Pemphigus vulgaris, often involves the mucosa, while Bullous pemphigoid doesn't. Note that, as obvious as that sounds, if a bullae is easier to rupture, the patient's more likely to present before you with ruptured rather than intact bullae, or simply erosions. That's also the rationale for the Nikolsky sign. If rubbing the patient's skins causes an erosion, causes it to shed, to slough off, that means the epidermis is definitely friable and delicate, so we are talking about more superficial blisters. This indicates the blisters are intra-epidermal, but it's not pathognomonic for Pemphigus vulgaris. Now, of course, the location of the bullae has everything to do with which structure is being targeted by autoantibodies in these autoimmune bullous diseases. Since the bullae in Bullous pemphigoid are sub-epidermal, you can guess the targeted structure has function in preserving the adherence between the epidermis and the basal lamina. And indeed it does. We are talking about the hemidesmosomes, mostly the type 7 collagen portion of the hemidesmosomes. On Pemphigus vulgaris, meanwhile, the intra-epidermal bullae must derive from the destruction of a structure inside the dermis responsible for attaching dermal cells to each other, and that is the desmosome. On pemphigus vulgaris, we have autoantibodies against the protein desmoglein 3 and desmoglein 1 of the desmosomes. So, when we have desmosomes between cells and hemidesmosomes between a cell and the basal lamina? Because, contrary to cells, the basal lamina does not provide a half for the desmosome. So we just get half a desmosome, a hemidesmosome. And then we have acquired blistering skin diseases that are strongly associated with another comorbidity. Dermatitis herpetiformis, for example, presents symmetrically as many itchy blisters on extensor surfaces, not large bullae, just small blisters resembling herpes, thus the name herpetiformis. It's mediated by deposition of IgA immunoglobulins against transglutaminase in the dermal papillae, causing subepidermal blisters. Hence, it's found only in the presence of celiac disease. If a patient with celiac disease develops blisters, the first suspicion should be of dermatitis herpetiformis. Dermatitis herpetiformis is more common in Caucasian males between 15 and 40 years old. These diseases are usually suspected clinically and diagnosed through skin biopsy. There are some technical findings that may be notable from a dermatopathological viewpoint, or alternatively, from the viewpoint of a test maker. Acantholysis, which is different from acantosis, is the pathological finding of loss of intercellular connections between keratinocytes. It has lysis on its name, so you already know we are talking about destruction. Now, did I say acantholysis is the loss of intercellular connections between a keratinocyte and the basal lamina? No, I didn't. I said it's the loss of connections between keratinocytes. So, this is happening right in the middle of the epidermis. It is intraepidermal. Which disease did we talk about that has intraepidermal blisters? Pemphigus vulgaris has intraepidermal blisters. Therefore, pemphigus vulgaris displays acantholysis. What about bullous pemphigoid? Does it display loss of cohesion between keratinocytes? No, just the detachment of the mass of keratinocytes from the basal lamina. That's not acantholysis. In the same way, if I say immunofluorescence found IgA autoantibodies, we will most likely think of a disease somehow strongly associated with mucosa. Maybe an enteropathy associated with the duodenal mucosa, maybe celiac disease, and so we are surely referring to dermatitis herpetiformis. Then, what autoantibody do we find in the other immunobullous diseases? Mostly IgG. Although, I'm sure if you hear about a condition such as IgA pemphigus or linear IgA dermatosis, you will correctly guess there are exceptions. If you are a dermatopathology enthusiast, however, you may protest. You have talked about the blisters in pemphigus vulgaris and bullous pemphigoid. What about epidermolysis bullosa? What's the site of blister formation within the skin? Besides, is it autosomal dominant or recessive? The best answer is yes. Epidermolysis bullosa is a large complex of inherited diseases with lots and lots of subtypes. It can be mild to lethal, and blister location and inheritance pattern are all over the place. For the same reason, talking about presentation is a bit pointless since it can vary so much. Treatment of dermatitis herpetiformis is quite intuitive and straightforward. Cease glutton consumption. No glutton, no IgA. No IgA, no autoimmunity. Dapsone may be used acutely, but a gluten-free diet usually provides a substantial improvement in the skin lesions. Treatment of immunobullous diseases such as pemphigus vulgaris and bullous pemphigoid, like most autoimmune diseases, aims to achieve remission rather than cure, and involves some degree of immunosuppression, relying mostly on steroids, sometimes associated with anti-metabolite drugs such as methotrexate and azathioprine. Anti-CD20 rituximab is also used specifically for pemphigus vulgaris treatment. Additional medication for improving pain and preventing infection of the lesions may also be warranted. Unfortunately, in epidermolysis bullosa, since there is no autoimmunity, but rather just the missing or defective components of the skin, immunosuppression is of no use. Treatment is usually somewhat limited to caring for the existing lesions, such as wound cleansing and debridement, and treating complications. Promising clinical trials may enable novel approaches, such as gene therapy, in the future. Thank you for watching this video and for choosing to spend your time with me. Please bear in mind that this is not medical advice. If you believe you or someone you know may have a blistering skin disease, please seek your physician. If you believe one of your patients may have a blistering skin disease, please check the latest guidelines. And if you are interested in dermatology or other medical themes, make sure to check my videos and playlists on it. Thank you once more for watching this video, and I hope to see you on the next video.